drinking this album. Listen to the brews. I think it would pair well, if only for you, because it's album and brews. It's album and
brews. Hello, friends, and welcome back to Album and Brews, stickiest music podcast. My mouth always writes checks that my ass can cash, and my name is Sarah.
Wait, before we get started, are we rolling?
We're rolling.
Yeah. Gotcha.
Oh my God. You fool!
I had that in since this afternoon. I was
like, yes. Oh my God, that's so good. Okay.
That's really good. That's really good. Ladies and gentlemen, introducing me. Not a butthole or made out of chocolate. I'm Zach. I'm your other co-host.
Your podcast hosting Starfish.
Yeah, I'm your hot dog flavored co-host.
That's a good one. I feel all insecure now. Those are all so good, but you know, hopefully now that we're here, the album reviews podcast gun give it to you.
Thank you.
There we go. DMX reference.
DMX reference. Yeah.
Like crazy.
Yeah.
Well, we are super stoked to have Jack and Grant from Chicago local band Screeneers on. Excellent intros. He made a pun
that
before we even like made our puns.
That was crazy. We're gonna be usurped.
Pun inception.
There you go. Can I say?
But you guys are out here killing it. You got your latest single, Passenger, that came up recently. That rikes. People can go listen to that wherever they are on the internet. Mm-hmm. They can go follow you at Screeners Shy on Instagram. Got an album coming out. Can you tell us anything about that?
Well, there's 4 songs on it that are on Spotify and everywhere else that you listen to music. And it's like a semi-concept album. So, yeah. And then I guess, I don't know. Anything else you want to...
No, yeah, that I guess just plugging the concept thing of the whole bit was, it just kind of like happened naturally. It was like, I don't think we like planned to like do it, but it just happened with like the songwriting and everything, and especially with the stuff we've been doing since we've been out of the studio and recording, like it's really kind of come together to be something really cool and cohesive as an album. So that's pump
hell yeah. Nice.
Also shout out to Wynn Klepper and
Matt Kellen.
God damn, that was brutal. All right, but shout out to them. Wynn Klepper is in a band with Zach here.
Oh yeah,
so
Clapper. yeah
shout out
absolutely.
That's so cool. How did you guys get making music together? I've never heard the story, because we also share a practice place for the listener at home.
Yeah. Well, there were a couple songs that were like, I don't know, pretty much done, no lyrics or anything, but Grant was living across the street from me in Forest Park, and I don't think we like hung out that much at all, but literally lived across the street. So yeah, we got together and kind of showed him these songs, and for a while it was just us two.
Yeah.
Like writing it and put it together, finishing things, and Grant brought his stuff, and then we got in touch with Wynn, because I was like, gotta have Wynn. They're just like
they're
sound,
so amazing,
which is such a good, and we struggled for a little while to find a drummer, because the original drummer, Liam, was out of town working and stuff, and then he came back, and then, you know, decided to kind of continue his career out of Chicago. So that's kind of the complete unit. And then Matt Kellen joined after that.
There you go.
I should also clarify, we went to the same high school and never talked to each other. I don't think even once.
I don't think so.
So we went to high school, never talked. We're neighbors that never talked. And then we started a band.
Yeah.
So, wow. Yeah.
That's so slay.
Yeah.
It's like the opposite of like most of Wikipedia bios you read.
Right.
They're like, so and so were best friends all through high school, and they made it their dream. And you guys were like, we didn't even look at each other.
Yeah.
Jack and Grant were barely strangers in high school.
Ships in the night for many, many moons.
I will say there were like a ton of mutual connections, like in terms of bands and just like Elmhurst, York High School music scene, like still to this day is really cultivated and something really amazing. So
well, speaking of high school, none of us were in high school when this came out.
No.
But I think people in high school would like this album.
Say something about the Lime-A-Ritas.
Will you guys tell us about what you picked to drink and listen to today?
Well, the album is Chocolate Starfish and the Hot Dog Flavored Water by Limp Bizkit. The greatest album. I picked this because Jackson Bigweather, who previously did Coldplay on this.
Yes.
Yeah.
And I like the idea of having to like defend an album, you know what I mean? Instead of picking one that everyone already likes, like being like, all right, let's switch it up. Yeah. So that was kind of the inspiration behind that.
That's a good pick for that sort of thing.
Yeah. Absolutely. And we needed a white trashy drink, so we got some Lime-A-Ritas. And I'm so excited. It's just been sitting on this table for 15 minutes and I'm ready to go.
I know. They're looking to burst.
Yes.
Should we get a nice good crack?
So the band is from Gainesville, Florida. If like you didn't know just by hearing them once.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah.
So I like to think this is like the unofficial state drink of Gainesville, Florida.
I like that.
Where's Bud Light from?
Bud Light? Isn't they like Missouri?
Yeah. Well, this could be a very Missouri drink too, but people in Missouri like Limp Bizkit and Bud Light.
And Bud Light.
That is so yummy. Target
market. So funny.
I was talking a little bit earlier about how Zach sent me a gorgeous text today asking if I had the time and energy to buy Cheez-Its and Lime-A-Ritas for tonight. I said, yes, I do. I will take a look and see if my... I
didn't realize how novel of a sentence that was.
Oh, it was so stunning. It was so beautiful. Like, I want to almost put it on a t-shirt. But they don't sell the tiny cans anymore.
Yeah.
At least not by me. I live, like, near a bunch of small, like, 7-Elevens and, like, tiny little grocery stores. I'm, like, not even a full-size Target. So, like... everything's very small, and I go to the same like little grocery store a lot and have for the last several years, so I like know the cashiers there to an extent. I was like, it's a Monday at like 12:30. If I walk in and I don't buy Lime-A-Ritas, if I walk in and buy four tall boy Lime-A-Ritas, they are going to like send someone to do a wellness check.
Yeah,
they're gonna. So, and Zach, I didn't say this earlier, but you may notice that our Lime-A-Ritas have two different tab colors. Two of them are silver and two of them are green. And that's because I got too embarrassed to buy four Lime-A-Ritas, so I went to a second liquor store and bought two more Lime-A-Ritas at a later time that day, today.
That's so funny.
So two of these are from Food Smart, the one on Armitage, and two of these are from Vast Foremost Liquors.
If someone saw you do that, they'd be like, she is an addict. Oh my God. She's can't even buy it all in one place. Oh no.
They're cutting her off now.
Yeah. Just do what I do and tell every person that works at a liquor store that I'm buying liquor for a music podcast.
I thought about it, but then I was like, then they're going to ask what we're talking about. I have to be like, Limp Bizkit. I will say, Food Smart was 30 cents cheaper per Lime-A-Rita.
I would not have guessed that.
Food write Smart's that down.
Pretty. Wow.
But how much were the Lime-A-Ritas?
They were at Food Smart, $3.49 a piece.
That's crazy.
At Vast Foremost Liquors, they were $3.79 a piece.
Where I went to school in Bloomington, you could get two for $3.
Thanks, so, Joe Biden.
Yeah, for real.
Yeah. Shrinkflation. Mm-hmm.
But yeah, it was a very economical way to get drunk in college.
Yeah.
I'll say that.
It still feels economical.
Yeah.
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 This is great for our podcast budget.
Yeah. Huge. Huge. The accountant's going to love this one.
Speaking of accountants, I don't know what your game is about. Is it about numbers at all?
Actually, yes.
Yeah, I guess.
Actually, it so damn is. Okay. So, I have a game prepared. Nice. Allow me to move my little laptop around. So, in, I believe, I'm going to call it the first official track on this album, Hot Dog, there is a lyric where this song has the word fuck in it a lot. This album has the word fuck in it a lot. I take no issue with that at all. Love me some profanity. But there's a lyric that says, if I say fuck two more times, that's 46 fucks in this fucked up rhyme. So he's been, you know, counting these fucks in this song. And it reminded me of when I was a child. I had a friend and I would watch movies with this friend a lot. And I went over to her house one time And we did this with her mom. There was parental approval here. We were probably in like sixth or seventh grade. We went over and we watched 21 Jump Street together. And we counted the number of times they said fuck.
In 21 Jump Street?
In 21 Jump Street. For the record, it's 125 times.
That's a lot.
Whoa.
Yeah.
That's more than Limp Bizkit, actually, yeah. In that song.
Yeah, by a lot. Wow. So I got curious. I was like, what other movies like count or like, I'm sure people have counted the number of fucks in different movies. I wonder which ones have the most. And I found what is probably my new favorite Wikipedia article called List of Films That Most Frequently Use the Word Fuck. It has a list of movies, the number of fucks in the movie, as well as the fucks per minute calculation.
That's good to know.
I have pulled a number of these movies.
How do I get that job?
I know. Oh my God, it's so good. The three of you are going to be against each other in this game that I'm calling fucks per minute. yeah. And I am going to give you the name of a movie. I picked ones that I think were all pretty mainstream. Most people have seen these. You each are going to guess the number of fucks that you think this movie contains. This also is counting for permutations like fucked, fucking, you know, things like that. Okay. And the person who gets the closest to the actual number can go for a bonus point and guess the fucks per minute calculation.
Oh, I see.
Does that sound good?
Wait, yeah. So we're guessing the fucks per minute? You're guessing, give us a movie and we're guessing fucks per minute.
You're guessing the number of fucks first.
I got it.
If okay. You are the closest, you can go for the bonus
got
point.
It. Okay.
And that's I'm the ready. Fucks per minute. Okay. Movie number one is Superbad. I don't care who goes first. You can just shout it out.
Superbad?
Superbad.
Well, that's a short movie, right? That's like a 90 minute.
That's got to have a high fucks per minute because there's less minutes.
I'm going to go 173.
173 fucks. Okay.
Just for reference, you said 21 Jump Street had 125.
That is correct.
It's got to have more fucks than that. Or okay. At least the same. 119.
119. Okay.
I'm going to go low. I'm going to guess 105.
Grant, you were remarkably close.
Wow.
It has 176 fucks. That's what's up. In the movie.
I study that Wikipedia page every night. It's my favorite thing.
Yeah, it's your bedtime story.
Yeah.
I don't have any of the run times written down because then you could just like do the math. But what do you think with 176 fucks that the fucks per minute calculation for Superbad would be?
I'm guessing it's like probably like over not like a little over 90 minutes, you know.
Probably.
Wait, Superbad's the one with Michael Cera and
Jonah Hill. Yeah. And, yeah.
So probably 1.8 or something.
Not quite. Fairly close. It is 1.56 fucks per minute.
That's a lot.
But you
movie.
Still get the regular point.
Dang.
Okay. Up next, this one I think most people know is a heavy hitter. In this category, another movie with Jonah Hill in it. I'm realizing several of these have Jonah Hill in it. The Wolf of Wall Street.
Oh,
that's so many.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Also, that movie's like 7 hours long. Yeah. And it's just mostly the F word. So.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You go 225.
Okay.
419.
That was almost really hilarious.
Yeah, I know.
That was oh.
Get it.
Well, so I got this. I'm gonna go. We gotta shoot for the moon here. Let's do like 523.
Grant again.
Wow.
There are 569 counts of the F word in The Wolf of Wall Street.
That's so many.
It is a long ass movie.
Yeah.
As you know, what do you think the FPM is on this one?
Wait, sorry, you said 569.
Okay. 569.
I actually think I know that it's almost exactly 3 hours.
Uh huh.
So give me a sec. Okay, wait, hold up.
This is gonna be.
I'm gonna
very
like
impressive.
Nail this. Yeah, I'm just like, trust me. Wait, we said 569. Mm-hmm. I am gonna do 3.1.
I will give it to you. It is 3.16 fucks per minute.
There you go.
Holy shit.
I didn't expect us to guess fucks per minute to the second decimal point.
You know what? That's fair. That's fair. I should have rounded.
Yeah, how are we rounding this? What's the... Yeah.
The fucking... The Wikipedia has it to the second decimal point.
Are they going to the moon? What are they calculating?
This is like in the Library of Congress at this point. Okay. Early lead by Grant. Up next, we have the funky little whodunit horror ditty Bodies, Bodies, Bodies.
Oh, I never saw it.
Oh, it's so fun.
I didn't see it.
Who's in it?
The guy from SNL.
Yeah, Pete Davidson's in it. Oh. Rachel Sennett, but I don't know if you know who she is, but she's funny. 22 or 23? Recent. Is very recent.
I feel like I don't hear the F-bomb as much as I used to.
Sure.
So I'm going to guess low. I'm going to guess like 86.
Sure.
I've been really striking up by guessing low, and I'm bad at averaging things in general. 200.
Okay.
Solid. Oh, man. I don't know. I'll do something in between. I'll do 143.
Yes.
Nice. You were so close. It is 194 fucks.
Yes.
With that information.
I clearly have a lot of information that helped me make that decision.
You've seen the movie and you love the movie, and you know it front to back.
Can I ask the runtime?
I don't have it written down. I could Google it. Fuck it.
I haven't seen it, so
but then you're just gonna do math.
How about I can't do math, dude? I don't know math at all. This will be fun for people to see how I can't do math.
This one's gonna do a math quiz.
Let's not do it. I'll guess.
I can't find it quickly, but I remember it being like between 90 minutes and 2 hours.
Oh my god, dude. I'm just gonna say a number because I'm like my smoke's coming out of my ears right now. Let's go with like two.
Two
literally, quite literally, yes.
Yes.
204.
Nice. Whoa.
I love this for you.
Well, you didn't get 0-4, so I mean.
No.
Yeah.
I'll take it. This is a tall order. Okay, we have three movies and then a surprise bonus round left. Okay. Number four is The Big Lebowski.
What a great movie.
One that I haven't seen, but I have had a white Russian, so I think that makes me qualified.
We are nihilist Lebowski.
And there's like bowling in it.
There's bowling.
I've never seen it. I should.
Have you guessed The Big Lebowski?
It's kind of
I've seen it like a million times. Yeah. I love that movie.
That's one of those.
Yeah,
it's a good one.
Putting pressure on yourself this round.
I will like randomly think about the scene with the coffee mug and just laugh. Or the coffee tin.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
It's just, it feels like there's a lot of flux. I'm going to say 165.
Mm-hmm. I'll go 175.
I don't think of that as a particularly fuck heavy movie. Like, it's not what I would put on my top list of like, this movie has a bunch of fucks.
Sure.
I'm going to go with 137.
Jack. You got it again.
Hell yeah.
But it wasn't very close. You still are the closest. It's 281.
That's a lot more fucks than I thought.
That's crazy.
I was going to think.
Where are the fucks in
it's
that?
It's very
movie?
Subtle.
Is it the Germans? Is it?
Honestly, yeah. Good call. Yeah.
Yeah. With that, do you want to go for the bonus point?
I think it's just the dude being like, oh, fuck. Like, you know, it doesn't
They're probably
they're not like Wolf of Wall Street fucks. They're just like,
go with 1.7.
It is 2.4.
Yeah.
That's all right, though. You still got the point. Next penultimate movie before the special bonus round, Hot Tub Time Machine. I'll say this. This might help you all out. All the movies on the list that I pulled from have at least 150 fucks. Anything under that is not on this list.
That's so funny. Where there's some, you're like, oh, that's a great movie. Not 150 fucks. Sorry.
Yeah, so like 21 Jump Street wouldn't even make it on this list.
Dang.
Which is Cucarino.
I'm going to say this one has a lot. I'm going to guess 375.
Okay, swing big.
263.
Okay.
I've never seen Hot Tub Time Machine.
I haven't either.
I'll go 239.
Great. You're the closest. It is 212.
Nice. Okay.
Much more tame. Watch it with your grandma.
Yeah, truly.
That's the one where Ryan Gosling. Who is it?
One of the hot ones.
One of the hot ones. Like
Gyllenhaal, maybe?
No, it's not. I almost said Jake Gyllenhaal, but it's not. Who is it? Channing Tatum.
Channing Tatum?
Yeah, he's like a weird sex slave. Spoiler alert.
Sure.
Yeah, that's This Is the End.
Oh, yeah.
Sorry to correct you, bro.
No, you
did.
Yeah.
I know my Channing Tatum cameos. let me tell you.
Oh, so I haven't seen Hot Tub Time Machine.
So none of us have seen
Way different
So
movies.
You're like, wait, isn't that the one where he hasn't seen it? Yeah. Do you want to go for the FPM here for Hot Tub Time Machine?
No. Is that two? So we got 212.
212.
All right. I'm going to guess this is a solid 90-minute overstaying your welcome movie. Mm-hmm. So that'd be 2.5.
You're a little high. It is 2.14.
Okay. All right. Wah.
Okay, this is the last movie before our special bonus round. Very stressful, very high stakes movie. Uncut Gems.
Uncut Gems. I haven't seen this one. Have you guys seen this one?
Yeah.
I think it raised my blood pressure.
It's been on my list for a while.
It's good. You should watch it.
It's amazing.
It's really good.
Is it?
Yeah.
I kind of thought it was going to give me like Click.
No. It's like actually like a good
movie. No, it's like good.
Oh, I've been sleeping on it, I guess.
Yeah. A24, mama.
Oh.
Yeah.
What are you trying to say about Click? Right, masterpiece
like,
of a
like
film.
Like it was just like him being serious and it wasn't good. I don't know.
Yeah, no, Uncut Gems is actually good.
It's good.
Okay. I cried at the ending of Click.
I actually got some like sad moments in it, honestly. Yeah, unironically. Yeah.
Hey, welcome to Adam Sandler Watch.
We could turn this podcast around just right now.
Just
talk about
8 Crazy Nights, bad Adam Sandler movie.
Sure.
Someone else go first this time.
Oh man. I'm gonna guess 387.
Okay.
I'm going low again. 315.
Okay.
354.
You said 387?
Yes.
You are the closest, but it is way higher. Uncut Gems has 560 bespoke iterations of fuck and its permutations.
My goodness. That's the most so far.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. I mean, that movie's so fucking stressful. It's so stressful.
Is that like one of the, like, what are the top ones?
So Wolf of Wall Street was, I believe, number 2 or number 3. Uncut Gems was also very, very high up. Okay, Wolf of Wall Street was number 3. Uncut Gems was number 4. But the top 2 are movies I've never heard of. The first one is called Swear Nut, the movie.
That checks out.
Yeah,
it's a 2014 Canadian dark comedy film. I see the poster for it here, and at the top it says "fucking swear." So, Swear Nut, the movie has a runtime.
I bet that was directed by Fred Durst. He loves that word.
Directed,
you know?
Starred, produced.
This is him saying that word.
It came out in 2014. It has 935.
Wow.
Jammed into its,
what is the
112.
FPM on that?
That has an FPM of 8.35.
Wow.
Which is insane.
That's like one every 12 seconds.
No, less than that. It's like one every like 8 seconds.
Dang.
Wow. That's brutal.
Cam, check my math on that. The second one is a documentary called Fuck.
Well, that's cheating.
Yeah.
I mean,
yeah. I think it's like a censorship documentary.
Okay.
Yeah. So I skipped those and I picked 2 real movies.
Okay.
Okay. So, Grant, you have pulled ahead like a crazy, crazy horse, but it's not over yet. We've got one last special bonus round where you are going to guess the number of fucks in chocolate starfish and the hot dog flavored water.
Oof. And the whole record.
The whole kit and caboodle. The Spotify version, I believe. So I think it's, I know there's like an extended,
edition
or whatever.
Tracks, yeah.
I think this is like the CD you could buy.
Did you look this up or did you count them?
I looked this up.
Okay, gotcha.
If I couldn't find it, I would have counted them.
Yeah, I appreciate your dedication.
Thank
to
you.
This
show. Thank you. But thankfully someone did that work for me.
Yeah. I did count the fucks in one of the songs, the one where he's like 46, and I was like, is it really 46? Let's find out.
Mm-hmm.
I'm just gonna guess like 30 times 30 times 13. Yeah, I'm gonna guess 425.
Nice.
Okay.
Right by Wolf of Wall Street.
Wow.
Yeah. Going with 700. Oh my God. There's 15 tracks on
here. Fuck it. Yeah, swing big. Swing big.
It's around 40 to 50 per track. Yeah. Which honestly, I was like, all right, like enough several times.
Yeah, a little too crass for you.
Sure,
yeah,
sure. Yeah. Clutching the pearls.
I'm gonna go. I think y'all are insane. I'm gonna go with like 200.
Great, you have taken it home. It has. I was surprised by how low this number was. 122.
Really?
Over That's the course crazy. Of the album, it one feels song like has a lot more.
One song has a third of the fuck.
Maybe that's why he had to like call it out.
Yeah.
In that one.
Yeah.
So it wouldn't have even made this Wikipedia list.
Wow. Wow,
that's so sad.
With that, you want to go for a final FPM here?
FPM of Limp Bizkit?
Did you calculate the FPM?
Yes, I calculated the FPM.
Hell yeah.
Okay, well.
Because I'm a scientist.
I re-listened to this album the other day, and I was like, this is, like, long as hell. Like, it's crazy how long this album is.
Yeah.
That it's, part. Like, well over an hour.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
So I'm going to actually, I'm going to go with, like, 1.2.
A little low. It is 1.65.
Okay.
But admirable mental math. Grant, with that, you took this shish home, and I will crown you the fucking Limp Bizkit genius.
Absolutely.
For this episode. Thank you for playing.
Thank you.
I thought you were going to give him like a fuckometer. And like, you pointed at the song and it tells you the.
Shit, I don't. The patent for that didn't clear yet. Oh, man. I thought we weren't going to talk about that.
Oh, we do that again.
Sorry.
So, that was great. That
was so I'm such good. A fiend. I'm like, yeah. Wait, we're doing. All right, here we go.
Grant was making that gulping noise the whole break. He was just downing the Lime-A-Rita.
Dude, I'm on my fifth Lime-A-Rita right now.
We're going so fucking crazy.
Before we get into it, I want. So, we know Grant picked this record because he wanted to come and defend it.
Yes.
Yes.
But Jack, why did you also pick this record?
You know, I'm not gonna like totally defend this record. Just to be like totally clear.
I love that.
But yeah. I think it's like it represents like a really important time in music. And it represents like both like what is happening right now and why there's so much like new metal and stuff coming around, but then also like what should have and indeed did stay in the past in terms of rap rock. That's not just Limp Bizkit, but lots of rap rock.
Yeah.
But
yeah, yeah, yeah.
Historically, I think it's important, right?
Like, yeah, like I guess so.
This blur
yeah.
of two genres you wouldn't normally put together.
Yeah.
So
I don't know if I could like fully defend the album as a whole, but certainly like, I don't know. I think there's things like I enjoy about it and Limp Bizkit as a whole, I think. Like more as a concept, I would say I'm like way more of a Korn person. Like if I'm gonna choose, like
Korn is great.
The bands, like they've always been like I could digest like a whole Korn album. Just you know, I don't know why they tickled my fancy more, but
yeah. Yeah, I was trying to like figure out like a Venn diagram of like what you could describe Korn and like Limp Bizkit and Linkin Park, mm-hmm. like rap rock, trashy. Korn yeah. and Limp Bizkit, like rap rock kind of smart, Limp Bizkit and
yeah
and Linkin Park.
I think Korn's smarter than Linkin Park. No,
oh, is it?
I mean Korn is a lot like they talk about some real shit, you know?
I mean Korn is definitely more emotional, like,
yeah,
well
yeah.
I see both of those bands are pretty like, I don't know, they're both about like childhood trauma a lot of the time.
Yeah,
I feel like, yeah,
maybe Korn expresses it in a way that's more digestible to me, but yeah,
you're into scatting,
like, no I mean I don't know, I just feel like the limp, like Fred Durst thing, like they have a lot of like anger and a lot of like, yeah, like fuck you and like kiss my asshole, you know? Yeah. Like, and it's like it's like all right, thank you, I will do so, you know? But I mean, there's a time and place for that. And I think, like, Limp Bizkit is also, like, on the political sometimes, too. But, yeah, I don't know. Maybe I just, like, can interface with corn more.
But there's a legion of TikTok that says that corn is girly pop.
Oh.
And by extension, Limp Bizkit and Linkin Park are also girly pop.
Girly pop.
It's like, kind of... younger, like Gen Z girlies in the car, and they're like, so girly pop. It's Limp Bizkit being like, it's just one of those days. And I kind of get it. We've all had days like that, and yeah. They're just so girly to be pissed off.
It's hot dog flavored girly pop, yeah.
Thank you. Yeah, yeah. But when you said corn, it made me think of that.
We got to talk about chocolate starfish. Yes. That's a butthole.
That's a butthole.
To my understanding, yes.
Yeah.
And so the fact that he chooses to say it in like every two songs.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He's just like, butthole.
Well, he says butthole actually as well. Yeah, like, yeah. Several times.
But
too,
he'll just be like, chocolate starfish. Like in a real like DJ like a producer Khaled tag. Kind of way.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah.
The fact that he's just referring to a butthole.
Really weird.
It's really good. It's like one of my favorite musical choices.
It's a choice. It's definitely a choice. Yeah.
I think it's appropriate for Limp Bizkit. You know what I mean?
Totally.
That's their shtick.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
Are y'all familiar with like the chocolate starfish and the hot dog flavored water? Are you familiar with how the hot dog of it all came to be?
Pray tell. Was, yeah.
apparently, it was sort of like this inside joke with the band where they were at a gas station and they were looking at like bottles of water. And you know, there are bottles of water that are like wild berry and orange, you know, flavored water. And they were like, why don't they make like meat? Like hot dog water. That you can like buy at a gas station. Yeah. And so they loved that joke so much that they made it an album title.
Everybody's going to love this.
And little did that gas station know that they would be responsible for the greatest album name of all time.
Yeah. Zach like sent me this after y'all picked it. And I'm not familiar with Limp Bizkit. Like, I've heard break stuff. Like, you know, yeah. that is where my familiarity starts and ends.
Yeah, Nookie.
And so you sent me this, and I clicked on it, and I saw this egregious-ass album art with these weird little, like, blob men, and it said chocolate starfish and hot dog flavored water, and I said, what the fuck are we getting into? Yeah. And then you texted me, like, 2 days later, and you were like, we're drinking Lime-A-Ritas, and I was like, what the fuck are we getting into? I had fun listening to it. I should say that, but also like I feel like rap rock can sometimes be sort of like the grimiest genre. Yeah. Like I listen to it and I'm like, I feel like I'm in like the back room at a Walmart.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's like something like very like 90s and like back like, room of like, Walmart-y.
It's like pants that you've worn for a week.
Yeah.
You know? It's like pants that you've worn for a week. It's like the bucket at your grocery store that they use to catch the ceiling.
But here's
leak.
The thing is like they're doing this on purpose.
No, yeah. Exactly.
It's named after a butthole. I mean, it's gross.
Crazy.
So I've got a fun fact here about why they named themselves Limp Bizkit. Did you guys realize? Did you guys know this?
You told me at one point. And
there is like an awful Urban Dictionary. I don't think that's real. I think someone just put that on Urban Dictionary. I'm not going to repeat it because Cameron will edit it out.
Yeah, that's fair.
But they named themselves Limp Bizkit because they were looking for names that like gave people the ick. They were looking for names that would like turn people away from listening to them if they weren't the type of people to be like, oh, let's like see what this is.
Yeah.
And so here are some alternative names. And according to a 2013 Reddit AMA.
Let's go.
And they're really good. Grimp Disco was one of the ones. Grimp. Fred was That's thinking good. About. Split Dick Slit.
That's a drag king. Yeah. First of all,
Bitch Piglet, not as good. Here's my
Bitch Piglet.
Here's my favorite, Blood Fart. You're all around a circle night talk about the band Blood Fart.
I need to Google something really quick.
So track number intro.
Just straight going into it from period poops. No.
No, please.
I don't know if this record needs an intro.
No, I kind of live.
You kind of live for it?
I kind of live. It reminds me of like a really like kind of doinked up like back alley clearance bin version of like the Midnight Marauders, like A Tribe Called Quest, sort of like spoken interludes.
Yeah. It's kind of interesting because like they do the whole rap thing where they're supposed to be an intro and outro and interludes, but like they don't do any interludes.
No, there's like,
it's just songs.
They've done it on other albums, but on this one, they were pretty much pretty straightforward.
Well, that's they were going for that, right?
Honestly, the intro gets me kind of hype. Disco, Limp Bizkit's in the house,
it's
you know?
It's really pop. Like, I was kind of hanging out with it. And there's like the bit later in the album where it reminded me of this because it was kind of this like meta, like on Midnight Marauders, the like voice interlude diva is like, this is what Midnight Marauders means. You're listening to this record right now. And it's very like, look at you listening to this thing that you're listening to. It's kind of that, like, you are doing this. Which also reminds me of this book, not to be literate on Maine, called If on a Winter's Night, a Traveler. It's very heady, but it's like this book about you, the reader, picking up a book and reading the book. Is like kind of how it starts.
Oh.
And I love shit like that. Kinda I eat meta. That for breakfast.
Yeah.
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 So Limp Bizkit is a postmodern band. I think we can all agree. Yeah.
Postmodern.
They tell us right off the back that it is reality, which is like, they're so right.
Exactly.
They're so smart.
Spitting truths just straight up.
Yeah. Has anyone like written a thesis on Limp Bizkit?
You know, Wynn's friend was, or Wynn was telling me about their friend who did like an ethnomusicology thesis about how like nu metal is like the new folk music of like the Midwest and Southeast.
Because it did have a big movement in the 2000s, right? Like it was.
Mm-hmm.
It's for the people, you know what I mean? For the collective, you know?
Definitely.
Yeah.
There was that Adam Neely bit where he did a whole video about how, like, people remember the music of their childhood when they're old.
Yeah.
And so, like, you know, people that are old now are, like, thinking about, like, jazz and stuff, and they can remember all the lyrics, all their jazz tunes. But us is going to be like... all these rap
you visit me in a nursing home and pray break stuff. I swear to God.
I'm breaking a hip, I swear to God.
Yeah, I'll be able to walk again immediately. It's going to be crazy.
Their thesis was that rap rock was the folk music of 2000s Midwest.
Something like that. Yeah, like from like the,
that's sick.
The late 90s to the early 2000s.
Yeah, it's crazy.
I'm probably butchering that.
Yeah, well, it's just crazy to think about how popular it was 20 years later, 24 years later.
Like new metal.
I remember metal was all over the radio stations when I was a kid, right?
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Especially like, I mean, not like, I'm just like the range of new metal as well. Like you kind of had the very bro-y Five Finger Death Punch, like the kind of like that was like weirdly emotional, but like very hidden behind a lot of masculinity thing.
It was for like military bros.
Absolutely.
Your conservative new metal.
Yes.
Avenged Sevenfold, or were you cool and like listen to like Ask Alexandra?
That's not new metal. Well, Avenged Sevenfold is awesome, so how dare you.
I like Avenged Sevenfold. Definitely one of my childhood favorites.
And the tea is like, okay, this might be controversial. No, it's not. New metal and like rap rock isn't dead necessarily. It's kind of, I think, been rebranded. But these are still artists, like recently, I think of like a Lil Uzi Vert. I think of a Rico Nasty. I think of a Post Malone. Like people are still doing this genre blending today, perhaps with a more contemporary facade or like lens. But I was like, that kind of like humbled me a little bit when I was thinking about this album, and I was like, how fucking silly. Like I was like, no wait, valid.
Well, also like y'all heard the new 100 Gex album.
Yeah,
like it's just new metal. Like and like the new metal is like making a legitimate return.
Black Midi, like
And even like, honestly, the other thing too is like, there's a lot of like rappers of like the late 90s that you don't think of as like new metal artists, but like mm-hmm. incorporated like new metal type stuff, like Jay-Z or like, okay, Pharrell Williams got his start in a new metal band. Mm-hmm. Everyone forgets that.
And then he wrote Happy.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
He's like, awesome. He's not in a new metal band.
That was
band
his
anymore.
Breakthrough. So it's like, I don't know. It was like a lot. I think it had like a lot bigger reach than like what we think of as new metal today.
Yeah, totally.
That checks out.
Wow, I love this Socratic circle.
Yes.
Yeah.
Should we get into a hot dog? We're going to go track by track. Let's... Hey, if you were selling hot dogs at a ballpark, how would you call to people to let them know that you are selling hot dogs? Like, you're walking around the stands, you have a warming basket full of hot dogs, and you want to sell them to people.
Hot dog.
That quiet?
Oh. Hot dog here!
Nice, yeah. Nice.
That's good.
I would like go in between each of the rows and ask each person individually. Like, sure, whisper. Would you like a hot dog? And like make people like move their legs as I like walk with my box.
Oh, nice.
Definitely a classic. Just like hot dogs and then bang the like little thing.
Yeah. Have you done that in a past life?
I think maybe. I've always really seen eye to eye.
That seems very natural.
When I was like 5, I would watch those guys. I'm like, those guys are so cool.
Yeah, no, they get to go to every baseball game.
Yeah.
Honestly, so I watch them today, and I'm like, those guys are so fucking cool.
Yeah.
Like,
that's
a
awesome.
Fun job. It's like some retired dad.
Yeah.
He's like, hot dogs!
I know someone who knows the Wrigley Field organ player, and that is like literally the coolest job.
That's a flex.
That could even be imagined. You know what I mean?
There's not a lot of people like that left.
Yeah. And it's like an actual organ that they have in Wrigley. It's not like a recording or anything. Mm-hmm.
So that's sick.
Amazing. Yeah.
But I want them to do Limp Bizkit on the organ. So start a petition to make
the he does. He plays player. Like contemporary versions of songs.
Let's get him to play hot dog.
Be pretty sick. Yeah. It'd be appropriate.
Yeah. It's about hot dogs.
It's instrumental. This song's fucking crazy.
I like the
crazy opener.
I like the Nine Inch Nails reference. Did you guys catch it?
I did not.
And Billy Corgan has a writer's cred on this song.
What?
Deadass.
You didn't catch the Nine Inch Nails reference?
No, I didn't.
I know like nothing about Nine Inch Nails, so
and
please.
Billy Corgan?
I meant Trent Reznor. He's like talking about fucked up, whatever. A Nine Inch Nail, I'll get it knocked the fuck out. And then a little bit later, he quotes, what's the Nine Inch Nails song?
Closer.
Yeah.
Closer.
Yeah.
So he like almost barely says the same words in the same cadence.
Okay. Yeah.
This was meant to be a diss track at Nine Inch Nails. Which is
and he
awesome.
Opened with it?
He opened with it.
Yeah.
Because they had like a spat for some reason. And first off, I think there's an entire Wikipedia page devoted to like feuds with Fred Durst, which is awesome. But it's like in this one, it's like he wrote the diss track and then like Nine Inch Nails were just like, okay. And then just moved on with their
life.
I can't imagine like so Trent Reznor being like, oh, I'm gonna write a song back at you, dude. Yeah.
He heard this, he was like, well, this band will be around for 6 more months. So I don't think I really need to put a lot of effort into responding here.
Oh my god.
No, hot dog rocks. It like it reminds me of like when I was a kid and I heard the F word for the first time.
Yeah,
I,
but it's like the
I
whole
have,
song.
Exactly.
But like when you first hear it, you're like fuck yeah. Like you're just so you feel so powerful, you know what I mean, as a child knowing the F word.
New lease on life.
Yeah.
I remember like hearing some of these songs as a kid. One of my older brothers must have had it as like a CD. I remember being like, that's so many bad words.
Yeah.
This is a like a brother band. This is the kind of band your brother shows to you, like your older brother, and you're like, oh my god,
it's
this
a
is
very
so cool.
Older brother band.
They're swearing. I feel so cool.
Yeah. I personally like listened to this track today and was like, God, I can't wait till this is over. it was just like, oh, but you know, like it did make me like appreciate that era of like, it is like. And I think, like, the reason Limp Bizkit spoke to so many people and is like so long lasting in a weird way is because it like really did tap into like youthful rebellion. It is the band your older sibling showed you or you heard from your friends older, you know, like it's just, it's, it has that. And it's also like happened at a time too, when like, you know, this is in the tail end of like Nancy Reagan and Tipper Gore and the parental advisory stuff too. So it's like really society bro level, you know, too. So I don't know. Like I would never listen to this song again there. I'll say it. However, like it really needed to happen.
Yeah.
And it's like really important. Because of that, so
that's I'll bare my soul as well. I opened a private session in Spotify to prep for this episode. I've learned my lesson. I've learned my lesson after several years of like artists we've talked about on the show showing up in my Spotify Wrapped highly ranked.
Yeah. Oh like, God, yeah.
That's I would tough. Rather be shot in the foot than have like Limp Bizkit be my number four spot dog.
Well, I feel offended because that was legitimately on my
I think I'm here to help you defend it too.
Yeah.
I think I'm here a little bit.
Jack is, I brought you in as backup and here you are just trashing it. Like,
well, I think I'm giving a very balanced perspective.
Exactly. I didn't hate it.
For Grant and my generation.
Yes.
Thank you.
Which is not Generation X. Which is like crazy to think about that's who he's talking about.
You are so crazy transitioning to this next song, My Generation.
Talking about how Generation X was seen as violent. I'm glad millennials weren't seen that way. We were just seen as lazy.
Lazy, yeah.
Which is like fine. Like pay us more.
yeah. I'm technically, I think, the oldest of the Gen Z. What do you think the Gen Z stereotype is? Like dumb?
Just like addicted to your cell phone, I think.
Sure.
Yeah.
I don't know, do you guys have any Gen Z?
I would say that like in a part of technology.
Yeah. Glued the screen time.
Social media.
Off the charts.
Do you guys remember dial up?
I was also gonna say people shit on Gen Z, but they're like, I'm at the tail end of Gen Z as well. Mm-hmm. 97 is probably, that's the cutoff year, right?
Yeah.
So I guess I think I'm like fully established as the first year, but. So I don't know if I like totally identify with like, you know, people in college classrooms right now. But however, like they are like so much more politically active than I ever was at that age. And like, I mean, they're doing really important stuff. And I think like the young people are doing great things. And I, in a sea of like people saying they're stuck on their phones, I do want to say that. I think there's like a good part to their stereotype too.
I do have hope for them.
They're definitely like a lot more like lefties than in any other generation.
Yeah.
I feel like, which is cool.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Come on, y'all.
can we play a little intro of My Generation?
Yes.
Yeah, Diva.
This is such like an auditory time capsule for me. It like puts me right back. Right back in my 10-year-old body. Like,
yes. Yeah.
All right. Put your seatbelts on.
If only we could fly. Just that reverb. That 90s reverb.
It just came out 2000.
I know, but
the
90s,
it's... And then until
the 90s exist till 2007.
Yeah, pretty much. Yeah.
Okay. What's 90s up? Like one of the best era for drum mixing at all of all time.
Yeah,
drums sound so freaking good.
Yeah, 100%.
That shit's crisp.
Steve Albini. He didn't do this album, but he's in the
90s. Yeah, that would be hilarious.
I would love that.
He taught at my college.
It would just be the most contentious recording session of all time. So many people hating each other. Oh, that'd be awesome. I will say, like, going off of that, like, the, like, if you become 10 again.
Yeah.
Like, I feel like it's like, I've been told that like a lot of people like watch like The Simpsons to be like, oh, I'm like a kid again. This is reminds me. Mm-hmm. I listen to Limp Bizkit to remind me of these things.
Yeah.
Like, this is what this is for me. It's like the nostalgic, I'm a kid again type
Hell
thing.
Yeah.
You know
I thought maybe
mean?
It was a nostalgic thing. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, of course. But like, you know, it's also great, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Can I say?
Sure. Parts that's like it. When I listen to Nelly Furtado.
Yeah.
And it's like, or Fergie.
Nelly Furtado rocks, yeah. Honestly.
That part.
Yeah.
Just the like childhood aspect of this. I feel like that is so true. And that's something I connect with this album. Like a hot summer day on my dumb bike.
Yeah.
We're going through the streets of Elmhurst to like shoot hoops at my friend's house. Like listening to Roland.
Yeah.
You know, yeah. Like that is like full. It's very visceral. It's like the yeah. smell thing. Like it just brings you there.
Yeah. You know? Yeah.
Yeah, you can feel the rubber on the asphalt of with your little bike and
yeah,
so good.
I did notice looking at the lyrics of the song that it is such a time capsule, and I'll bring that forward with the lyric: "We downloaded Shockwave for the ladies in the cave," which is a software that was used to watch Flash videos, now defunct. Like Adobe Flash.
Oh man,
they killed that when I needed it most. To be honest,
which at the time was super hip.
That's so funny.
That's like writing a song and being like, "I got music off Napster." Like, yeah, like girl.
Yeah.
Or like if it was in like 2013, being like, "She was my iTunes free single." Like, like it's such a
really a time capsule.
A time
really
capsule.
Puts you right in the moment.
Yeah.
It'd be cool if there was like a modern band that just did all of those references. That'd
be kind of, see who picks them up.
Yeah, it'd be a cool like shtick. I don't know. I
yeah.
like that. Someone should start that band.
I Chicago. Was thinking that like there's not just because this song undoubtedly made me think about the Who song.
Yeah,
which parallels it in just being so on the nose about my generation mm-hmm. and like rebelling against the youth, but also totally being in context of like a super mass market album. But also like at the same time, record execs like are just throwing money at anything,
yeah.
you know, and like it is radical to a weird extent. And there's talking to people to like a really weird extent, too. So, yeah, I don't know. I think that's really cool.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Cool.
Do y'all know what a full Nelson is? A wrestling move. Have y'all like seen a full Nelson?
Yeah, it's like twice as much as a half Nelson.
I didn't know that.
Wait, I don't know what either of these are. What is a full or half Nelson?
So a half Nelson is like when you got someone in like a headlock, but it's one arm.
Yeah.
And a full Nelson is, I did wrestling for like one time. I got too stinky at school, so I quit. But a full Nelson, you got both arms underneath them.
You like wrap which them is like under the armpits yeah. and behind the head.
Yeah. It's like a,
and then
yeah.
what do you just throw them? Or? That sounds really you like
take them
dangerous.
To Pound Town,
yeah.
baby.
Yeah. So that's so true. Yeah,
you can't do that. You can't take them there.
You can't. Is that against regulation? Yeah. Shit, I wasn't a wrestler. So.
This is a Lime-A-Rita conversation. Lime-A-Rita fueled, you know.
So it's a little kind of like jockey of a reference for
it is,
which I think like kind of like works out for how like heavy the song is and stuff.
Yeah, this is my favorite song on the album.
Yeah. I love this chorus.
It's a banger. Okay, so I've seen Limp Bizkit like countless times, and every
live?
Time, yes,
work.
Wow,
I've seen them like over five times for sure. But and every time during this song, they bring a random person from the crowd on stage to do the rap, and you know it's like, why is everybody always picking on me? Why is everybody always picking? So they like rap. He raps with like
work
wow.
with Fred Durst, and it's cool because it's like sometimes they get up there and they're like kind of nervous, but then sometimes they just like own it, and it's
fuck
like
yes.
it's a very endearing and wholesome moment in the Limp Bizkit show.
It's fun, like you said, it like makes their fucking life.
Yeah,
yeah,
and it's just yeah, like it also like as an audience member, it's just endearing to see just a normal person living it up.
Totally,
up there, you know what I mean? Like that's so cool.
Hell yeah! I want to listen to this chorus.
Yeah, yeah.
Real quick. Do like, it. It's so fun. And I'm halfway through my Lime-A-Rita, and I'm like,
I mean,
I don't have a time stamp unless you do.
It's like he wrote it about when I eat spicy food. Your mouse is writing checks that your ass can't cash. I know.
Okay. I'm going to, I might have to skip around a bit. To my face, you'll get knocked. Your mouth's writing checks that your ass can't cash. Spicy. Knock straight the fuck out.
The production is so 90s. I love it. Yeah. Or 2000s. Yeah.
Fred Durst sometimes does this like old timey gangster mouse affect. Where he's like, hey, boss, like, if I was a William, like, you see me, I was writing chicks. Like, it's so fucking funny.
My favorite thing that he does is, like, the Adam Sandler voice, where he's like, right now I'm dangerous. Yes.
We're talking about the same thing. Yeah, exactly. They're synonymous. Yeah. I love it.
Yeah.
I don't love it. Like, I want all my music to sound like that. I love it. Like, yeah, you go, girl. Like, yes. You make that choice. That's so fun.
Yeah. That's awesome.
Oh, my goodness.
Well, if I had it my way, we would talk about the next track, My Way.
Whoa.
Which is like when I read that this was used in a WWE official theme song for WrestleMania something something 2001, I was
Yeah.
If they didn't do that, someone should get fired.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. I thought the sample that was used in this one was fun.
They sampled My Way by Frank Sinatra.
They sampled My Melody by Eric B. and Rock'em. It's like a rap song. Mm. So I want to play a little bit of the original.
Because
I mean, it's not like they did a crazy amount with it, but it's fun to hear.
Yeah, the samples seem to be like really nuanced. You know?
Yeah.
Like the samples are like barely...
Like it's,
they're not like driving the
yeah
song.
Right
yeah,
uh-huh. Right
they're like Easter eggs
versus, and they're also like, not crazy like shot like I feel like the samples that I've heard are it's pretty straightforward
yeah
it's pretty straightforward you'll hear it. Nobody beats the R. Check out my melody. So that comes through in My Way by Limp Bizkit like this. It's like a little ghost.
Yeah.
But yeah, it's pretty straightforward. It's just kind of like...
Oh, but they like back slowed in the mix it down a little bit
with some like, guitar in front. Like,
huh. It's really
cool. I like it. I think it's tasteful.
That reminds me of like, I don't know, there's a lot of, that's almost like Beastie Boys or Sublime level sampling where it's just like one of those things you hear and you're like, whoa. Or you just don't notice it at all because it's just so like, I would admit, I didn't know that. I thought that was just like them doing their thing.
Totally.
You know, but do you remember now they do have a DJ? He wears the mask, right?
No. Well, so Wes Borland is the guitarist who like dresses up every night.
Okay.
The DJ is DJ Lethal of House of Pain Jump Around fame.
Oh, fuck yeah.
Jump Around.
I'm
yeah.
from Wisconsin.
He like Fred Durst like met him and then got like Wes Borland, who is like actually like an incredible guitarist.
Yeah.
And the drummer does like jazz stuff. He's like actually a really talented, skillful drummer. So the band is really good, you know?
Yeah. I think.
And then there's Fred Durst.
I think it takes talented people to make stuff that borders on meme.
Yeah.
You know? I think it takes very talented people to make like outlandish shit and pull it off.
Yeah.
You know? Like,
yeah.
I don't think, even if it's like not your taste or whatever. I don't think you can really say that, like, the people playing in Limp Bizkit, like, aren't talented.
Like, if they were bad musicians and made an album about buttholes, like, it would be bad.
We wouldn't be doing this.
Right.
Yeah. Well, the thing I've always thought is, like, pop music in general, I feel like, has always had, like, a comedic element to it. Mm-hmm. Like, every good pop artist is, like, sort of a comedian, too. Like, they can't take themselves too seriously, otherwise it's, like, off-putting, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. So, I don't know, you know?
Yeah.
I'm into it.
It also takes talent to do the thing you're making. You know? Like, you can't do that shitty. Be like, I'm making fun of it. I need to suck.
Yeah.
Yeah, they gotta be a little funny, so they've got me rolling. Air raid vehicles.
Also, your transition so far. I don't want to jinx you, but.
What if they really named this song Rafflecopter?
It's just because we pay by the minute and I can see the clock.
Hey, peeling back the curtain a little.
I'm forced to be witty because of capitalism. Track number.
Back to fucking WWE.
Yeah.
This was the Undertaker's fucking theme song for a year.
Yeah.
That's sick as fuck. That's sick.
It's a WWE wrestler's theme song. Like, that's what they wrote it for, unknowingly.
Because before I saw that it was the Undertaker's theme for a little bit, I was like, this would go crazy at, like, Monster Jam.
That
would be so sick. That's exactly the space for the song.
Can we play the chorus? And then can we find this little silly rap section that I think is so, so good?
Yeah.
And really just different than the chorus?
Yeah. Hands up, hands down. Back up. Tell me what you're gonna do now.
Yeah. I want to yell yeah at a song like that someday. Okay, so now will you play a minute 20?
Absolutely.
I just like it a lot.
I love that. It just tickles your fancy. Yeah, okay, man, so Limp Bizkit, because we get it all win every day and every night. It is platinum. Oh, I didn't know Eminem was on this track. Get some better rhymes. We got the go. Never begging for a rain check. Old school soldiers passing out the hot shit.
That like
wooden bounce in the mosh pit.
Piano thing.
Yeah.
That's really great.
It's tasteful.
Yeah.
It's really good. I
wanted to mention about this song. So speaking of incredibly dated references, the music video for this song, they're playing on top of the World Trade Center.
Stop it right now.
They are, yeah.
In the year 2000.
Yes. And because they did that, there was like a 9/11 truther conspiracy that like Limp Bizkit was like part of the like, like
this,
inside job.
This album came out like a month later, right? Or a month later from
I think
9/11
came out in 2000. If I'm not mistaken.
Oh, that was in 2001.
Yeah.
Dur.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Okay, that makes sense.
It's wild.
Because that would be crazy if it had been released like the same year.
Exactly.
Yeah. But
we've talked about records that have been like put off or like they got rid of songs after 9/11. So it's like
Bleed American.
Yeah, we talked about Bleed American.
They had to change the title. Yeah.
Yeah.
So that's wild that they did that music video.
Yeah.
Good timing.
I just like it because you said, like, there's like a lot of artists from like the 2000s. Like, I know like Wilco was like a famous one with like Tall Buildings Shake and all that.
Yeah.
But it's like, I just love it because like Limp Bizkit is just like such a not metaphorical band that you can't possibly find like double meanings in their music.
There's no metaphor.
All of their songs are either about like being angry or like
I got bitches just, like, in my truck.
I got bitches in my or it's like we are Limp Bizkit. That's the name of the band.
Well, I'll give them one metaphor.
Okay.
Chocolate Starfish is a butthole.
That's true.
Not a metaphor. You know what?
Chocolate Starfish can't melt steel beams. And it's I've always said
hot dog flavored water
can't melt steel beams.
That's the worst sentence I've actually ever heard. You come to me in my good mood. Sit on my pink couch.
We're talking about an album released in 2000. All right?
Come on.
Yeah. What do you want?
This next track is dedicated to Ben Stiller.
Shout out Ben.
This is
Stiller.
The greatest intro of all time. If you want to play the intro, it's amazing.
Oh my fucking god.
Dedicated to you, Ben Stiller. You are my favorite motherfucker. Drama makes the world go around.
And then there's the Adam Sandler voice again.
Yeah.
Do you guys know about the cameos?
I think in the last track,
you mean?
Hey.
No. The cameos of Fred and Ben Stiller movies.
He's in
Zoolander.
What?
Yeah.
Gorge. And then I think I saw that Ben Stiller is also in a Limp Bizkit music video.
Yes.
Rolling.
That's so fun.
You could have like told me that and been like true or false $1 million, and I'd have had no idea what to say.
I would have been like, what?
I'm like, I don't know, dude.
What do you want me to say?
That could either be super real or super fake. I don't know.
It was such a like random friendship to read about.
Yeah,
like
yeah.
they were like, yeah, Fred Durst and Ben Stiller are like besties. Like they have like, this is not real. They have like BFF bracelets. Like,
I bet. I mean, you know,
that's crazy. I don't know. Like, I don't know if you know, like how they met or like any of that, but.
Well, I know that Ben Stiller is like, he's actually like in a lot of music videos and a lot of like 90s rap music videos.
Hmm.
Like he's in, I think Snoop Dogg something.
Oh, and shit. Then,
like, I don't remember, but if you go like, I don't know, look up Ben Stiller's filmography if you're curious. And he's been IMDb. In like a ton of music videos.
I did not know that at all.
Yeah, he's a rap fan, I guess. Hmm. So yeah. Good for him.
Hey, learn something new every day.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
Crazy. And it's funny because in all of the music videos, he plays the character that's like, turn that noise down over there, you rascals.
Yeah. And he's been typecasted as a...
Which like makes sense, yeah.
Yeah. Hey, that's fair. Someone has to play the straight man.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
Yeah.
It's very like Night at the Museum of him.
I love the Eagles reference in this song. It happens twice and not like a ton of context about it. Right at the beginning, and he's like, I'm living it up.
Yeah. Life in the fast lane, baby. You know?
So, yeah, it's at a minute 20 if we want to hear the second good one. As soon as I heard it, I'm like, what is that? I know this, but I couldn't place it. Yeah. It was very Beastie Boys.
Yeah. Because Beastie Boys is like
all about that.
The tag.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Oh shit.
And it kind of made me want to sing Love in an Elevator. I don't know why, but that's kind of like a similar melodic pattern.
I don't know if I even picked that up when I was listening to it. I guess it's just something Easter on like the AirPods. Samples.
Yeah.
That's crazy. Damn. Well, before we get to the one, which is actually the eighth,
they fucked so that great. Up.
Yeah, morons.
Silly geez.
Shoot, guys.
Should we take a quick break? I need to go pee pee in the potty.
Go piss, girl.
All right, we are back. I'm about 8 ounces lighter, and we're gonna get into the one.
This is a skip track for me. I'm gonna be honest.
Really,
it's an interesting it's like energy shift.
Yeah. This one's sad. Wasn't really ready for him to be like emotionally available.
It's weirdly like
after everything we've heard so far, this was a curveball.
Yeah. I shouldn't say weirdly, but it's weirdly like earnest
For
a Limp Bizkit album called "Chocolate Starfish and the Hot Dog Flavored Water."
Yeah,
like you wouldn't expect. There's a song where it's like, what if we're not made for each other?
Yeah, him like just kind of like
what the fuck?
Soulmate? Like,
the entire first half of this album is like, fuck you, you don't even know me. I got bitches in my truck and I'm from Florida. And it's like, and now you're like, well, I guess this could be like at the point in the night where you've had like 4 whiskey gingers and you're like, maybe I've never known who I am.
Wow.
He's getting more drunk throughout the album. Yeah. That kind of makes, there's actually some like sadder songs on the second half for sure.
Yeah.
So this is the first of that.
You get through the hype drunk and you get to the sad drunk.
Yes, exactly. Yeah.
I do really love, they give the bass player some in this song. Yeah. Like in the intro, there's like a great line. You can play if you want.
Yeah, I do want. Like, this almost sounds like a Maroon 5 song.
Yeah.
Honestly, yeah.
Like, why they let him be so dirty? Just for them to get so sad. He should have been doing that this whole time.
Yeah.
Oh, he had some dirty shit earlier. The bass player?
I like that.
But this, yeah, this is the first.
This stole your heart. Yeah.
I see that this connected with you.
Yeah, I did like
that. Yeah.
I like that bass line a lot.
Yeah.
Yeah, the song sounded so like poppy to me, sort of.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It was kind of weirdly poppy.
What's weird is like, this is a side of Limp Bizkit that like, I don't think any Limp Bizkit fan likes, but like, Fred Durst clearly is so into it. Like, I've seen them live. And they do at least like 4 or 5 ballads throughout the set, which is something no one asks for. But they do.
That's interesting.
Like, I don't know. It's like there was one of the shows I saw them. They got acoustic guitars out and did "I'll Stop the World and Melt with You," So that's that's a curveball.
Yeah.
That was wild. And then they have the next album, they have a cover of Behind Blue Eyes, which is fucking terrible, but was actually a hit song. So,
I've got an awful fun Zach fact. One of like the first songs I ever learned on guitar was that song.
Hell yeah.
But it wasn't because of The Who.
Hell yeah, let's go.
It was the Limp Bizkit version.
Dad, I didn't know you were so cool.
I love learning about the people in my life.
I still know it. I can still play it.
Promise?
That sort of stuff really gets your groove on, you know?
Girl, yeah. Give it to us. Exco, give it to us.
Okay, honestly, this was like a good palate cleanser.
Yes.
This was fun.
It was fun. It brought back that like raw like energy you want to have at a Limp Bizkit concert.
Yeah.
You know? It was concentrated, and it was like, well, I just liked where it was placed in the album. It's more than like content to be. I mean, like just how it came after the song about, I'm just not sure if there is such thing as a one. You know what I mean?
Sure.
And then it's just like, yes, millennium shit, Limp Bizkit X to the Z. Yeah, is the first line of the song. It's like, dude, get back at it. I don't have to feel anything for 4 minutes again. Yeah. You know, it's good.
This is the part of the drunk experience where you're like, I'm actually not sad. I feel good. I'm ready to party.
You're like, you're in your bag. You're so sad, and then they play like "Call Me Maybe" at the club,
yeah.
And you're like, I don't have a care in the fucking world. Let's go.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah. Absolutely.
Yeah. This one felt like the most like 80s hip hoppy, right? We get like some real hip hop instead
which
of
like,
so much
like
metal.
Yeah. 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 Not, hey, well, Fred Durst doesn't have a bad flow when it comes to his rap delivery, but it was refreshing to have an exhibit flow present. I was like,
oh, this is really nice. Yeah.
Yeah. Like, this is nice. This feels good. This feels good.
Yeah. That could have been sprinkled in more throughout the record. We got 16 songs, like have more than one.
More features.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. I think, one of my like feelings about this record was at times it felt kind of samey.
Yeah.
Like a lot of songs had a similar energy to like break stuff. And I think like features and things like that are a good way to, not that I think they give a single fuck about this because it's Limp Bizkit. They're going to do whatever the fuck they want to do. But I was like, oh, what a refreshing change of pace.
Yeah.
Well, yeah. And it, I mean, like the beat is also like DJ Lethal, who has like the like 80s rap.
Yeah.
Like, actually a pretty prolific producer. So
yeah. I was into it.
It's a banger.
Yeah. It's fun. Yeah.
Can we just drop him into it just a little bit
of
to
course.
Hear like,
I'll just drop us right at the jump and we'll vibe with it for a sec.
Like already.
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Limp Bizkit. Thanks to the Z. Yeah.
What a great audience.
To you and yours. Ladies and gentlemen. My homeboy. Yo, get at him, dog.
You don't want to fuck with me today because a little something, something.
Adlib's been like, come on. He's like hyping this boy
how
up.
Inspirational.
Like,
yeah.
No, it's great though.
He's like, don't talk to me or my son ever again. Yeah. He's like, come on, Fred. Give it to him. But it's a vibe. It's fun.
It is. It's a different energy than I think I might have mentally mixed this one up with the other feature track, but it is like way more 80s groove hip hop kind of stuff. It's really refreshing, and it's really like, hell yeah, you're just like kind of cruising.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'll have more to say about the other one, but it like the other one sounds like mailed in compared to this, I will say. Which I like DMX, so that's saying something.
Well, we'll have to throw hands when we get to that.
Yeah, we will.
Yeah.
How dare you?
Yeah.
And it'll be an Album or Briz exclusive.
Yeah.
Screeners breaks up live.
What an awesome reason to break up. Like, mid like rolling air raid vehicle. How dare you?
We're off a Lime-A-Rita tall boy.
Yeah.
And you don't like this Limp Bizkit.
The fact that we haven't had a band breakup on air is pretty impressive.
No, yeah, we've been doing this for what, like 4 years? Yeah. Jesus Christ. Maybe it's a good omen to come on this podcast.
Yeah. Yeah.
Maybe it's like going to a marriage counselor. hey, take a look around. Look at where you are right now. What are 5 things you can see? 4 things you can smell? I don't know if you can smell 4 bespoke things.
Right, I can see 4 Lime-A-Ritas right here.
You could do that whole thing with Lime-A-Ritas. Smell 3
I see Lime-A-Rita.
Drink 2 Lime-A-Ritas.
Your therapist is like, this is not the goal of this, of this exercise.
And my therapist would be like, okay, that sounds like a fun night. Let's be present.
Let's be present.
Yeah. Let's shift to today. Yeah. And this moment. Shout out to my therapist. She's cool as fuck. Take a look around. What do I have written down here? This was one that was a bit lighter for me.
This was the credits song to Mission Impossible 2.
Yes!
Yes.
Okay. Was it the credit song to Mission Impossible 2 before the album came out or after? Do you know?
I believe it was before.
Okay.
I know this was on like that soundtrack, and then I think presumably they just put it on the album because it was a hit.
That makes sense because yeah. I was listening to this and I was like, this is a spy movie song.
Yeah. Yeah, to Mission Impossible.
Fully.
They put the lick in there like on purpose. Yeah. Yeah.
Like it's a spy movie song. I'm going to play a bit of it because it is... We're in the sort of energy shifting part of the album. Mm. We're kind of just trying things.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
like this could almost be like a double album. Like this could be a whole another album after.
Yeah, the yeah. Soul after, Searching yeah, Biscuit.
After
yeah.
Living It Up, you could have done another record with all this on it.
Yeah,
did I you could just also say, oh, go ahead. Soul Searching Biscuit.
Yeah,
that's gorgeous.
Soul Searching Biscuit.
That's beautiful.
Absolutely.
What were you
gonna I was going to enter a hot take that it could have just not been as long. Sorry.
Yeah.
Well, that is a little bit. There's a couple of skipper. Yeah. I'll give
absolutely,
you that.
Absolutely.
Yeah,
that's,
yeah.
Sorry to crush the double LP dreams of the possibilities.
We're like, we need more. Yeah. Let's get more tracks on this thing. Yo.
I will say, according to the Spotify metrics, this is the second most played song on this album.
Wow.
And that's really? I wonder if it's like people who really like Limp Bizkit or people who really like Mission Impossible.
What's the Venn diagram?
Like, hey, it has 366 million plays on Spotify. Well,
I honestly think like this song is probably the most digestible Limp Bizkit song in the whole album. Like he doesn't do the Adam Sandler voice. It's like the Mission Impossible riff. We all love that.
Yeah.
I just feel like it's like I don't know. I could feel like whenever I see like Spotify playlists of like 90s rock stuff and it's like Red Hot Chili Peppers and stuff and they need to throw a Limp Bizkit on here, they do like this song.
Sure.
They're not going to do like Hot Dog. That would be too abrasive. Like this is like more normal, you know.
You listen to Californication and then Hot Dog. Like, hey, how did we get here?
Yeah.
Okay, I'm going to play a little bit of Take a Look Around just to hear that. Okay, quick aside, because a siren just started outside my window. I was listening to this song this morning while I was walking to Walgreens to buy toilet paper. And I heard like a siren and I thought it was part of the mix in the song. So I was just like, oh. And then an ambulance went by me and I was like, oh!
Yeah.
Anyway.
I have a lot of like childhood experiences of like, listen, like trying to like play some of my music, be vulnerable in front of my dad and like in the car. And then it's like System of a Down or something. And there's a siren in the mix. And my dad's like, is that outside the car? Or is that like in the song? And I'm like, oh, it's in the song. He's like,
That's cheap. Like, it's like when you put the top light on. They're like, that's illegal.
Yes.
Yeah.
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 Yeah. I think it should be illegal to put like car horns in songs because then you're driving down the road and it's like, it's actually like distracting. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Or like how you shouldn't put a noise in a in a song that's like a pedestrian going, hey, wait, no, wait.
And you should never, ever put those noises in podcasts.
Oh, man. Someone's working a security job right now, and they're like, fuck.
I hope we have a security guard who listens to
I
our
hope
show.
So, too.
That would be so kick-ass.
If you're a security right guard in. Listening right now, yeah, write in.
Hey.
Yeah.
Okay.
Let us know if that spooked you or not.
Slide into these DMs, sweetheart. Okay, right. Now yeah, I'm going to yeah, play yeah. Like, take a look around. Okay. It kind of goes, though.
Yeah.
With the good comes the bad comes the good, but I'm gonna live my life like I should. Like I should. Now all the critics wanna hit it.
I'm also like, eat your heart out, Joe Dart. That like 16th note,
yeah.
Like baseline is pretty sick.
Yeah.
It's pretty sick.
Yeah.
And it does make me want to commit a heist.
Yeah. And Fred's like actually like kind of like rapping like pretty earnestly
like a
and like good
yeah.
and
yeah.
like not just like saying like butthole.
Yeah.
He doesn't mention that he's Limp Bizkit even once
yeah.
in the song, which
that's
is
so
crazy.
Brave of him.
Yeah.
Yeah,
absolutely.
Yeah.
He's showing a lot of restraint on this lyrically.
If I heard this song in like end credits, like I just watched a whole Mission Impossible movie. If I heard this, I'd be like, fuck yeah.
Hell yeah.
Like that was a spy movie, huh?
Huh.
That's awesome. I haven't seen that.
When did Mission Impossible 2 come out?
2000 or either that or 1999.
Oh wow.
Yeah.
Work.
Yeah.
But yeah, Joe Dart baseline. Shout out to Jack for being the first person to bring up Joe Dart on our podcast.
Woo.
Yeah.
Congratulations.
You actually episode. You get an award for that.
Hell
Joe
yeah.
Dart.
You do get a gold star for
yeah.
sure. Especially from Zach, who
yeah.
is a he's a bass lover. Yeah. We all are.
It'll be okay.
Ayo.
I had no notes on this one.
This one was sad. Back to the sadness
yeah.
again. Like this
yeah.
one was like, yeah, things ended. And what was the other one? Was it the one sad?
Yeah.
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 It's like, yeah, things actually ended. And he's like, no, I want to kill myself for you.
Mm-hmm.
This is like when after the Call Me Maybe part of the party, and it's like, okay, now I'm back to sadness. Yeah.
Yeah,
you know,
yeah. Yeah. You get like a weird text or you
yeah.
have like, you have like a missed call from your mom and you're like,
oh shit.
Yeah.
There you go.
I do appreciate the more earnest side of Limp Bizkit for some reason. I don't know. Just
sure.
we can move on. I don't
just like because like humanizing.
Song, yeah.
yeah,
he's not like
it
this
is.
Like WWE character. He's like actually a person with like feelings and emotions.
Yeah.
No, I mean there was I posted this on my Instagram story the other day. But there is this video that I felt like perfectly encapsulated all of what Limp Bizkit was, and it's like some summer. I think it's like spring break, Miami Beach. And they're like, y'all ready to blow this boat up? And they blow up a boat in the
yeah.
harbor. And it's like, dude, the environment, like the pollution.
Yeah.
Right? No regard to any of that. And people are like, yeah. And then they just go straight into a song. And it's so hype. And it's so cool. And like, I don't know. Like, all right, this is a little bit bigger of a thesis, but I do... Just because I'm on that topic, like, I mentioned the Tipper Gore thing and, like, the rebellion aspect of it, but I feel like there's this other side of the coin where, like, it also, like, bands like Limp Bizkit from this era represent, like, kind of just, like, the like, huge consumer culture, consume everything from, like, the 80s, too. Just, like, that super intense, like, yeah, just gaudy and, like, super in your face and who gives a fuck, like, all of that. But I don't know. It's kind of cool how, like, It's like, what are these songs doing on this album when it comes to like the sad ones? It's really it's enough to like make your head turn, which I think is
for
is
sure
cool.
Yeah,
they're definitely making, like, in words of my co-host Sarah here, capital C choices.
Capital C choices, thank you.
Absolutely. This felt like an album that like didn't really have a producer to say no to.
I think it was like Bob Rock was the producer.
Okay, then, yes.
I forget who it was. Terry Date. Okay, I don't really know what that is.
I saw a cursed video the other day of like the era of Metallica where Bob Rock was the bassist.
Yeah.
Which was pretty
the best
sick.
Era
yeah, no, honestly, could you imagine just like being like, I'm the producer for Metallica, holy shit. And then they're like, we hate Jason Newsted. He uses a pick, dude. So, what's your schedule like?
That's
and then
so
you're just
funny.
In Metallica. That's
great. Yeah, he's just the bass player for Metallica on accident.
Yeah. I love Bob Rock. I'll say it.
Yeah.
I don't have much to say about the next song, Boiler, but I do. Lyric, I crawled up your butt from hell. Very Limp Bizkit.
Yeah.
Very much.
You could say that on a Limp Bizkit record. Yeah.
Is it? Do you think, is it your butt from hell? Like your butt is in hell? Or I am crawling into your butt, comma, from hell?
That's
from
where
hell,
is
yeah.
Where is your butt in relation to hell? Is hell
well,
in your butt?
Yeah, where at sea level are you? Because hell is like probably a little bit below sea level, right?
It's pretty deep.
It's at the core of the earth, right?
Yeah.
Okay, one more thing just to add off of that thing
yeah.
about at this point in the album, like, butt was more offensive to hear than fuck.
That's
like,
crazy.
It got like to the point where it was more jarring to be like, kiss my chocolate starfish butt or so, you know, like just those like references were just like, just say asshole, please.
No,
like
right.
Say fuck, say something explicit.
Because he really
like,
never says
yeah.
like ass or anything.
Yeah,
he just says
no.
butt
yeah.
and starfish.
Yeah,
it. Yeah.
It's like,
yeah.
It was really jarring.
Pick up on that, but you're so right. He says the word butt a lot.
Yeah, it does.
And it's like, is that where you want to pull your punch?
That's I don't know, it just... And I felt that today it needed to take up space to say it.
Absolutely.
Yeah, so.
Thank you. do y'all have any other thoughts about Boiler? Do we want to hear anything?
I thought you were
going to
say
song?
Butts.
That too.
I mean, while we're on the topic,
the same
you know, yeah. I actually love Boiler. I think it's great because it's like, okay, so like I said, this is like a return to childhood.
Yeah.
This is like what anger felt like for the first time for me.
Oh.
And I want to highlight a couple of lyrics. Sometimes some things turn into dumb things.
Yes, wait, I love
amazing
that
amazing lyric.
Yeah.
But I like it because it's like, yeah, it's like it's a way to express like anger and like betrayal in a way that is like so simple that it
yeah.
like in a way is like actually, I think, like for me, anyway, it's like almost more effective of a way to describe that than being poetic about it.
Yeah.
Because sometimes emotions are actually painfully simple.
Yeah.
And it's just, you're just angry and there's just, that's it. And I feel like this song expresses that really
yeah.
well.
Yeah. So, I did love that lyric.
Yeah. Exactly.
It's like, it's just stupid. Like, fuck.
Yeah. Like,
yeah.
sometimes things just suck, you know?
Yeah.
You just
right.
have one of those days. And like, I feel like that's what, you know, Limp Bizkit is for. It's like when you need something that expresses your anger, but like is explicitly not poetic and like not trying to comment on the anger. Just I'm
yeah.
fucking angry, you know?
Yeah, there are days where you're not in a mood to be like, my lava overfloweth. Like,
yeah, exactly.
You just want to be like, fuck.
Stupid. Fuck. Just want to kick a rock.
You just want to be like, Ben Still is my favorite motherfucker. You know?
Well, I've never been that low, but.
Yeah.
There are very few bands that do what you just described, I think. I think
yeah,
there are,
yeah.
like, especially lyrically.
Yeah.
That's really rare. I mean, I listen to like a ton of hardcore and stuff, but all the like lyrical content of hardcore, if you look at liner notes and stuff, is like really political, really emotional, very deep stuff, no matter which way you cut it. But you know, I think the sound of the music like kind of makes up for that a little bit. And that's where you get that just like rage energy. But yeah, I think that's a really, you put that to words really well, I think.
Yeah, and honestly, I think like that's why a lot of people like pop music so much, is because like you said, like this hardcore stuff, like the genre stuff, or stuff that like, you know, like indie people would make usually is poetic, and that's great. Like, there's nothing wrong with that. I'm not saying right. it's better or anything, but like, you know, sometimes having just like plain explicit emotions, and also like I said earlier, like pop music is kind of comedy. Like plain motions that can like be made fun of is like a powerful thing. You
totally.
Know what I mean?
Totally. Yeah. To bring it back to like Carly Rae Jepsen, she has a song, "I really, 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 really like you."
Yeah.
I'm like, that's so cute. And also, haven't we all felt that way? And it's such a simple way of saying it. Not an ounce of metaphor here. And it's so plain. It's so accessible.
Yeah, you could do yeah. all sorts of metaphor around that, but not explain it in the same way as just saying really a bunch of times.
Literally.
Yeah.
Yeah.
No,
it's and awesome. It's funny. Like, it's fun to sing, and it's cute, and it's flirty, and it's yeah. like, I love pop music.
So validating.
Yeah.
I know, like a time where, like, I don't know, as you become an adult, I think you do a lot of work to, like, understand yourself a little bit more. And there's a lot that's important about that. But also just, like, you lose those childhood emotions where you want to, like, and you need to validate that, too. Just like, oh, yeah. I really like you. Or, like, you know, there's, I don't know, like, it's kind of funny how much, like, I don't know, I've always felt pressure more to, like, feel deep. Emotionally mm-hmm. and express those things that way instead right. of just being like, yeah, motherfucker.
We're simple creatures, you know yeah, what I mean? Yeah. We have base needs. That's what it yeah. is sometimes.
Literally. Sometimes it's not convoluted. Yeah,
that's huge. This is doing well for your defense of Limp Bizkit. This is,
yeah, so
this
there
is
we
good.
Go.
Oh, points yeah. for Limp Bizkit for this one. Well, hold on. Scott Weiland's in this one?
I'll be honest, I don't even know what the song is. I low-key like skip it so fast.
Should I just
it's crazy.
Play a little bit?
It's honestly, sure. Yeah.
Yeah.
It's like Stone Temple Pilots. It's Scott Weiland. I mean,
hey, yeah. my dear.
I actually like didn't love it, but like I liked Stone Temple Pilots.
That yeah. means so little to me. I don't know anything about Stone Temple Pilots. I'll play it a little bit because I've listened to it several times. But I can't say like you could play any song off this album and be like, oh, wait, this was a bit. Like,
it's objectively good guitar tone, I gotta say.
Yeah.
I
mean,
you keep your distance, I can't deny you. I got the feeling, can't satisfy you. I got your picture on. Picture long gone. You keep your
this is a Red Hot Chili Peppers song.
Yeah,
sure.
I was going Nine Inch Nails with it, honestly.
Yeah,
it sounds that? Like some downward spiral. For a band that hates Nine Inch Nails, they sure sound
hey, good. Keep your friends close.
That's
keep
true.
Your enemies closer.
Yeah.
It's just not what I really want from Limp Bizkit.
No, it's a little too, like, I don't know.
This is the cab ride home.
Yeah.
This is the Uber.
Once it hit those, like, chorus harmonies, I was like, all right, take it easy, you know?
Yeah.
Like, no, I didn't really want this from you guys. You guys are kind of, like, putting this on me, and I didn't really...
Yeah. I don't know.
No, this is absolutely the Uber. And the windows are rolled down, and you're like listening to this, and you're pretending you're in a music video.
Yeah.
Just while we're on the record, I must say, I don't know if I agree that that was objectively good guitar tone. It wasn't as bad as like metal clean guitar tone, but it just didn't do it for me to be like, yeah. Okay, the delay guitar though, like the layering and stuff, I'll take it, but.
There is some hilariously 90s guitar tone on it.
Yeah, that's what it was. It was like 90s
yeah, hard rock ballad.
Like
clean,
I was, I think I was describing to you earlier how like a lot of new metal songs have like an evil piano.
Yeah,
like Linkin Park, like a vibe. Like Limp Bizkit does that with like delayed guitar.
Yeah.
Like
they don't have a piano,
but they do the same thing. Basically,
downright villainous.
Yeah.
Well, so that's lucky number 13. Yeah. Hold on. Oof. Let's get fucking rolling again,
let's get straight into Jack's again. Favorite DMX feature.
Rolling to okay, electric was,
this song
Rogaloo.
Is
let's just preface it that this is a close to six and a half minutes, which is really pushing DMX.
But we also
Method Man
and Red.
Yeah.
Good Lord.
I was, okay, I think the reason I was like, oh, they mailed it in on this one was because I just like, I had like crazy expectations when I saw the features.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. I was like, oh, they're going to get their like cool ass verses and it's going to be like, X gun bring it to you. And it's just going to be like, oh, bah, this is the best of all the worlds. But it kind of felt like the, you know, when they like call in a big rapper to feature on something that like, and then but like it's very much for the paycheck for the guy to be on the album, so he's
sure.
just kind of like, oh, like making his DMX noises.
Yeah,
you know.
Yeah.
But he's not like, you know, he didn't like write a good verse or anything. He's like, let me get down to it.
It's,
yeah.
it's like Lil Wayne in that Weezer song.
Yeah.
It's like, wow, you must have spent 5 minutes.
Yes.
On this
yes. yes.
It's or, like a kid trying to turn in homework. Like, all right,
or DMX on the Metallica song.
That's true. That's true.
Yes.
Yeah.
Thanks, Bob.
Another
Rock.
Banger. Yeah. Have you guys seen that video?
No.
There's a video of DMX and Metallica in the studio, and like they're just like, because it was like the new metal era, and like they're all like headbanging, and it's like the worst fucking song imaginable.
I know. It's so funny that that whole documentary is about them making Saint Anger. Like, yeah. Lauded as the worst album of all time. And then like, the whole documentary is full of this, but specifically in that video, there's like excerpts where they're like, yeah, we're doing something new. And fresh. This is like cool. And
yeah, they thought
like
it was awesome.
So
yeah.
bad.
It's very Spinal Tappy.
Yeah,
it's like
yeah.
real life Spinal
real
Tap.
Spinal
Tap. Awesome. Yeah.
I'm Metallica, and I'm here to say I'm dropping new metal in a major way.
Yeah.
It's honestly not much better than that. Yeah, that's pretty solid, really.
That,
right? Yeah.
Thank
yeah.
you.
Actually, yeah.
That's like the one rap bit.
That's really good.
Is there anything we want to hear from Roland, or do we want to get outro?
I think this was on the Fast and Furious soundtrack.
Ooh.
Is that so?
Yeah.
I do. I will
so.
Ask Grant, mm-hmm. the beginning of Roland, mm-hmm. he's like, put the track on! Like,
play that,
that track.
Fucking track!
Oh, do you think that was ad-libbed or he was talking to the engineer? What is your take? would you need to hear? Should we hear it?
Let's ask
yeah,
the audience.
Yeah.
Okay,
let's ask
yeah.
the audience. They can't fucking respond. Well,
mail in your answers and then we'll come back. In
let's
three
get
weeks.
A PO box.
Sometimes
yeah.
they'll be like, turn the bass up, but it's like, are they ad libbing or?
Right.
Play the fucking track. Play that fucking track. Oh, that is Limp Bizkit.
That sounds pretty.
That beat rocks. That like. That's like kind of like Fly Low.
Yeah.
Like,
this is Swiss Beats on production. Which
oh
is
really?
Like,
that's pretty.
Yeah.
Dope. How do they?
Are you ready? Are you ready? You're moving, now move out. Hands up, now hands down. Back up, back up. Tell me what you gonna do now. Breathe in, now breathe.
Just lightly Adam Sandler.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Please.
I'm just a sucker for that like drum tone, the like 90s ass DMX,
yeah.
like X gon' give it to you. Like,
yeah.
it sounds like a toy or something. Like, I love it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, do we think he was like talking to the engineer?
Well,
or like when he said play that fucking track.
When he goes, oh, there it is. That sounds so sincere.
Yeah.
It
that
sounded
part
pretty
did.
Real.
That part.
Because he didn't sound angry when he said it. He sounded he was
no,
like joking around.
Like
so I'm like, that makes me think he was like just in the moment. Yeah.
I mean, I will give you, it is odd to not start the track in the beginning. It's like, how do you not know how to do that? Like, that's
yeah.
the easiest thing to do. So I will give you that, but I feel like besides that, that's it seemed pretty sincere to me.
Yeah, that's always a moment that's curious for me because I've always, I don't know if I just like am like see social interactions happen and get uncomfortable. But like on albums, like same. That's one of the moments that I'm like, Kanye's like, turn up the headphones. And I'm like, did you really say that? Or are you saying that so you say turn up the headphones?
Right.
And we think you're cool.
And we think you're in the
and
studio.
And it just makes me like shiver in the inside.
There are a lot of rap things that do like, yo, turn up the headphones. So it's like, I don't know.
Yeah.
At least some of them are probably faking it, you know?
Yeah, so that's...
Yeah, statistically, they're not all real.
Exactly.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah, it sort of feels like a cue to the audience. Of like,
I'm in the studio.
I'm in this shit. Like, yeah. I'm about to lock the fuck in.
Yeah. I'm a rapper. We're Limp Bizkit.
I'm going to drop some hot bars. Get ready.
Yeah.
I mean, it's good. Like, I don't hate it when
I wasn't mad.
A hip hop artist do that. Yeah,
no, I wasn't. I pictured him doing like a little hop, like to the beat, like just getting very excited to spit his verse.
That's funny.
Yeah.
I wonder if audio, like, because you brought it up. I wonder if audio engineers are like just kind of know, just kind of know what like.
When it's bullshit.
Yeah
I will say, like, being told like turn up the speakers in a song, I'm like, ugh, like I feel like, oh my god, I gotta turn up someone's headphones, you know?
Oh my gosh, did we get to the outro already?
Yeah, dog.
Outro. Wow.
And I'm so sorry to do this right now, but I actually need to pee again.
We had 25 ounces of Lime-A-Rita.
We had 25 ounces of Lime-A-Rita.
Is everyone done with their Lime-A-Rita?
Yeah, I'm so close. I have this much left.
Yeah, do it.
But I need to go pee real, like, right now.
Okay. So off air, Grant, you were telling us this is your favorite outro of all time.
Did I say that?
No.
You know what? Yeah, actually, it is. And I'm going to defend that.
All the skits and pauses and everything. Is...
I do, like, love it as a concept. It is excruciating to listen
to. It's so hard to get through.
So it's like, if you've never heard the outro, it's 3 minutes of Ben Stiller and Fred Durst and the guy from Third Eye Blind talking. And then...
Is it Ben Stiller?
It is Ben Stiller. He's on it. He's the one that's like, yo, when you guys came out with Counterfeit, that was like fucking crazy. That's Ben Stiller. And it's like, and then they're laughing, and then it's like one of them laughs, and then it's just like a loop of that laugh that repeats for 6 minutes, and then some other nondescript background music plays. And it's really just to piss you off. And I kind of like that, because it's like, if you're going to end, just... throw it all, burn it all in flames. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Jerry Lee Lewis once said, I don't care if the place gets burned down as long as everyone has a good time. I don't know if he said that, but I'm looking at it.
Consistent with the Great Balls of Fire.
Yeah.
He would
say it. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So it really, you know, does it even matter if he says it?
Not really.
So that's my take on the outro.
Huh.
Yeah. This reminds me of, like, we talked about the Childish Gambino, like, mixtape royalty.
Yeah.
And the last track on that mixtape, he literally, like, gives the whole ass outro to Tina Fey.
Uh-huh.
Fuck yeah, let's go.
She's just going through the end like, yeah, it's fucking royalty. Like, what are you gonna do about it? And I'm Tina Fey, bitch. And it's like, it's very similar.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah. You know, just leave him smiling. You know what I mean?
It's or cute. Angry. It's fun. Works. It's not 10 minutes long.
Yes.
But it's cute. It's cute.
I had like a fever dream experience with this outro. I was doing a couch listen to the record, preparing, and I took a little nap.
Okay.
And I wake up to this dream. This is how embedded Album of Brews is in my brain. I'm dreaming about talking with a coworker about schism. In my dream, I remember, like, we're having a conversation, like, is it 5 and 7 or is it 12, right?
Oh, that's a nightmare.
And then he starts laughing, but it's not his laugh. It's Ben Stiller's laugh, or whoever's laugh it is.
Yeah. And it's just so repeating, like, it's like he it's keeps like, laughing. Yeah,
it's like I have, that's like, this awful moment between dream and reality where I still hear the laugh, and I'm like...
God!
You're like, I can't keep doing this.
That's incredible. Oh my goodness.
My God.
It's really funny that I was dreaming about schism.
Yeah.
with that, let's get into our brewski.
Let's Hell get yeah. over to our presenters at the Brewski Awards ceremony. It seems like it's high time to give an award out to chocolate starfish and the hot dog flavored one.
Well, it absolutely is.
Yes.
Ladies and gentlemen, what a fine night it is. So. Is it not, Jack?
Oh, just everybody looks so beautiful tonight. I love nights like this.
Moose is giving you her whole ass.
Yeah.
Moose is giving you chocolate starfish.
Yeah. Everybody looks just so beautiful tonight. Yeah. Love nights like this.
We're here to present the award for Best Older Brother Album, which we'd like to thank all the nominees, Chocolate Starfish and the Hot Dog Flavored Water, the song What It's Like by Everlast, the movie Boondock Saints, the movie Memento.
Stadium hey, can Arcadium. I say quickly, those were both on the fuck list.
Really?
Yes, dead
Memento
ass.
Was on the fuck
yes.
Wait, what's the
I fuck list? I promise with my whole heart, the list of movies with more than 150 fucks.
Oh.
Why do they need to swear a Memento?
That's Sorry crazy. I would not
he
expect
He has fuck
Memento.
Written 150 times on his body to remember the word. What are some Damn. Other older brother pop cultural Nowadays.
I don't know. I'm the oldest sister.
Anything
so this is
by Eminem.
Eminem.
I'm the
yes.
oldest sister, so I can't really think a lot of Gwen Stefani and stuff like that.
Thank
That's
you.
True. Yeah, well, it's an older sibling. Let's be more inclusive here.
Britney.
Some Britney.
NSYNC. Yeah. Backstreet.
If you're like if you're a little younger, perhaps 5 Days of Summer.
Spice Girls.
Spice Girls. One Direction.
Uh-huh.
Harry Styles.
Uh-huh.
But anyway, we have to have one winner, folks. And the winner
so
of this,
many great nominees.
So many great nominees. But I mean, if you're talking siblings, we're all talking Chocolate Starfish and the Hot Dog Flavored Water by Limp Bizkit.
Yeah.
Congratulations. In a landslide, really.
Yeah.
Ugh. Well, folks, thank you so much for listening to another gorgeous, stunning, and work-friendly episode of Album or Brews. We have been Album or Brews, myself, Zach, and I. And God damn it, we will continue to be Album or Brews. If you want to check us out on Twitter and Instagram, it is at Album Rebrews, like reviews, but brews because like beer. And if you want to take a look at our website, make that Squarespace subscription worth it. It is www.albumrebrews.com.
A big giant thank you to our editor and singer-songwriter extraordinaire Cameron Bopp for taking care of the show all these long years and writing our fun little theme song that you're going to hear again in a minute. Go follow him at Evil Twitter, formerly X, now known as Evil Twitter.
Did you buy it?
Yeah. We'll sell it to anybody.
That's where the money's going. Yeah. That's why we had to have fucking Lime-A-Ritas this episode.
Damn.
Check him out.
At Cambot, CAMBOPP. He's a PP boy. Go check him out on Twitch, too. He's been streaming Elden Ring, and I've been, like, Dark Souls coaching him. Cambop17. A giant thank you to Jack and Grant from Screeneers for coming on.
Thank you.
You guys rule. Go check them out on Instagram at screeners_shy, like the city. And then go check out their latest single, Passenger. It's a great tune. And then keep a close, close ear to the ground for their soon coming album, TBD, TBD. Anything you guys want to say to the folks at home before we get out of here?
Can we end on an anecdote from a Limp Bizkit show?
Yes.
So I was in the crowd. I was going to the bathroom. And then a person in a full furry suit and mask came up to me and was like, "Where's the mosh pit?" And I was too taken aback to answer. And then someone was like, "It's over there." Someone had to speak for me.
Wow.
But it was the first time ever seeing a furry or realizing that they exist. So
how old were you?
It was tight. I was like 23. It was like a couple years ago. I thought like furries were like things that like kids made up online. You know,
yeah.
I didn't think it was
I
like a
you're
real.
You're gonna be like 12.
I
you
didn't
just, like see a unicorn.
Yeah, I knew of them, but I didn't think that they were real.
Wow,
so.
I'm glad we ended on that.
Yeah, absolutely.
We've been Wilco. Follow us at Wilco on Twitter and listen to Cool Country, latest album. That's it.
Well, with that, we're gonna do what we do at the end of every album. Episode. We're going to get very, very, very close to the mic. And in the same order that we introduced ourselves, we're going to say a sweet and tender and gorgeous ASMR style goodbye. I will go first. Goodbye.
Bye-bye. Love you. Bye. Goodbye, ladies and gentlemen.